Muy buenos días desde la Comisión Nacional para el Uso Eficiente de la Energía, la CONUE. Yo soy Juan Ignacio Navarrete Barbosa, soy director general adjunto de Políticas y Programas y tengo el gusto de presentar en este día el primer webinar de esta dirección. Los webinars forman parte de una nueva estrategia que estamos impulsando con el apoyo del director general de esta comisión, el maestro Don de Buen Rodríguez, con las expectativas de generar materiales de interés para todos ustedes en torno a la eficiencia energética y encontrar espacios donde podamos divulgar conversaciones para mantener vivas estos temas que pueden ser del interés de todos ustedes. Como ustedes saben, la interacción de la Comisión Nacional de Energía, de la CONUE, con distintos organismos, tanto nacionales como internacionales, es muy amplia. Y hemos decidido iniciar estos primeros webinars con la participación de una agencia hermana, la ADEME, la Agencia Francesa de la Gestión de la Energía y el Medio Ambiente. Y vamos a empezar con una presentación titulada La contribución de la eficiencia energética en la Ley de Transición Energética en Francia. Para ello, a mi lado me acompaña esta mañana el doctor Didier Boeuf, un gran amigo de la CONUE y a quien saludo con mucho gusto. Y antes de cederle las cámaras y la palabra, me gustaría leer brevemente su currículum. El doctor Didier Boeuf es economista senior de la ADEME. Él es doctor en economía de la energía por la Universidad de Grenoble. Es un experto en el análisis de la demanda de la energía, en proyecciones de consumo de energía a largo plazo y evaluación de políticas de eficiencia energética. Ha colaborado en distintos estudios para la evaluación de políticas de eficiencia energética para el Consejo Mundial de la Energía, el WEC. Ha sido también coordinador del proyecto en monitoreo de la eficiencia energética, el ODIESEY-MUR, para la Comisión Europea. Además, ha participado como delegado por parte de Francia en distintos grupos de trabajo, incluyendo organismos como la Agencia Internacional de Energía, la Convención Marco de las Naciones Unidas sobre el Cambio Climático, es miembro del Consejo Europeo de la Economía de la Eficiencia Energética, ha sido consultor para distintos organismos de las Naciones Unidas como la CEPAL, la Comisión Económica para América Latina y el Caribe, para el Banco Mundial, entre otros. Asimismo, ha sido autor y coautor de distintos libros y de distintos artículos en revistas especializadas para diferentes universidades de Francia. La siguiente presentación se va a llevar a cabo en inglés, por lo que para mayor comodidad de ustedes vamos a contar con una traducción simultánea. Así que vamos a pasar al inglés para dar la bienvenida formal al doctor Didier Boeuf. Welcome to the webinar CONUE, and welcome for accepting this invitation for the first webinar in the planning area here in CONUE. Paul, the voice is yours.
Buenos dias. Thank you for your invitation. It's always a good pleasure and an honor to present our works in France. And the topic today is to present the energy transition law that we are implementing right now in France. And this is a very important piece of legislative framework. And for example, for the election of the president, all the candidates were referring about the role they will play to implement the energy transition law. We have a collaboration with CONUE, with the French Development Bank, on exchanging information on the energy transition law, because you are implementing efficiency law, we are also implementing an energy transition law, and the idea was to exchange practice information on that. And this collaboration has started 1 year ago, and we are still continuing, and we plan to have a 3 year program on exchanging good practice. So today I will present our French energy transition law, and the title of this law, it's not really efficiency law, it's the energy transition law for green growth. What is important, this is a new way to present an energy law, it's because we have behind that the issue of environmental concern. So we are dealing with energy, but energy in the context of a better and sustainable development. So this is important to call that the energy transition for green growth. I will have two main parts. One is to present this transition law, how was the collaborative process made, and what are the main issues on this transition law. I will focus the topic on energy efficiency because the scope of the energy transition law is larger than pure efficiency. We talk about renewable, we talk about circular economy, waste management, air pollution, but I will focus, because we are with CONAE, with the energy efficiency. And as I'm participating to the French Energy Efficiency Agency, we have the role to implement part of this energy transition law. And it will be my last part of the presentation. What could be the role, or what will be the role of ADEM as an energy efficiency agency to implement the energy transition law for the government? Just one word for ADEM, where I'm working at the economic department. ADEM, it's a public agency, the national public agency, in charge of implementing policies. We are not implementing all the energy efficiency policies, because some are implemented directly by the government, and there is a slight difference with CONAE. We don't belong directly to the government. We are a side agency. But finally, our role is more or less the same, to implement policy. However, our scope is larger than pure efficiency. We are implementing renewable policies, waste management, etc. And what I will present now is a collaborative process. So this law, we start the process of discussing this law in 2013. And this law has been accepted by the Parliament in August 2015. It means we have discussed with hundreds of experts from ministries, from NGOs, from consultants, from university. To provide this law, we need 2 years. Okay. So this is, I will insist on that it's a very collaborative process with all stakeholders, including companies, to consumer association, to discuss the issue of this transition law. The main objective was to comply with factor 4. In Latin America, you are not very keen with that issue, but for the OECD, in climate negotiation, there were some agreements for countries which have to reach a factor 4 for 2050. It means that we have to reduce our CO2 emission per factor 4 compared to 1990. It's a huge effort. So, for instance, you have to reduce the consumption of your CO2 emission of your car by a factor of 4. So from 8 liter per 100 kilometer to 2 liter per 100 kilometers. So it's a huge effort. And this is to allow the developing world to emit more. And in total, we will be able to reach 2 degrees Celsius target, which has been agreed among countries during the COP21 in Paris. So first objective, first goal, to comply with factor 4. Then there are some sub-objectives, and all this discussion was based on the idea of a pricing of the carbon of $56 per tons by 2020 and $100 in 2023. So this is a signal that the price of carbon will increase. Some may say that this signal is not enough, and there are some exercises that we are doing in ADEM where we make some vision, long-term vision, with the cost a price of carbon at $200 or $300 per ton. So But the government fixed an increase, a price signal for the cost of carbon, which is increasing, more or less doubling until 2020. Third objective, this energy transition law is part of a multi-annual programming of energy. Every 2 or 3 years, the government make a discussion and make a plan of investment on all energy issues, in particular investment in energy production. And this includes, for example, target for renewables. Then we have made some macroeconomic evaluation, in particular at ADEM, in our economic department, and our assessment shows that energy transition law could be beneficial for the economic growth. We will have an increase of 3 points for our GDP up to 2050 and until 2030, 300,000 extra jobs and around 900,000 jobs. So this is a clear signal that this energy transition law is good on a macroeconomic point of view, both for GDP and for job creation. And this is clearly a message that green growth will create jobs. We are not alone in the world to implement energy efficiency law. And Juan, our colleague, mentioned that we work with WEC, the World Energy Council, and we make a survey around all countries in the world. And we can say that more or less between 50 to 60 countries in the world has an energy efficiency law. We should make a difference between an energy transition law, which encompasses all the issues of energy, for example, for France, the issue of renewable, issue of nuclear, but we need to have also a focus on energy efficiency. So the practice of Mexico or France, it's classic, but not all the country has an energy efficiency law, in particular in developing world. This law is made in 8 sections. First, as all type of law, we need to define the objectives. So there are a lot of set of objectives. And one of the new issues that we have developed, it's the development of sectoral objective. This is very important and new. We have objective for building, for transport, etc., which are quantitative and very clear objective. Secondly, there was a focus on building, clearly. We will see that our objectives are very strong in terms of construction of new buildings, in terms of performance of new building. We promote zero energy building. And it's clear that due to the national context of France, building is the most prior sector to work on energy efficiency. It was not the case 30 years ago when I started at ADEME, where the most important sector for us, strategically speaking, was industry. So clearly, this is building where we put our main effort because it creates a job and it's a lot of multi other benefit. We will develop clean transportation, and I think what we will present there could be interest of Mexico, since our common work shows that one of your main issue is transport. So I hope you can take some advantage of our experience. And this development of transport, it's not only for efficiency, but it's also to improve air quality and protect people's health. So there are multi-benefits of energy efficiency. I will use always this issue of multi-benefit because it's not a new concept, but it's a new argumentaire to push energy efficiency. We will work on, we have some objective on waste management and to promote circular economy. For you, it's for us, it's clear there is a relationship between energy efficiency and circular economy. In particular, when we're recycling product like glass, like steel, etc. We have a discussion yesterday on that for the industry vision for Mexico. We will, of course, encourage the level, the use of renewable energy in order to diversify our mix, and also to take advantage of our region resources, because France, unfortunately, has not too much natural resources like oil or gas. So this is certainly why energy efficiency is very important for France, for our energy security. As you may know, one particularity of our energy mix is nuclear. And around 80% of our electricity production is through nuclear. And all the debate in France are on energy issue are around nuclear. And this transition law allows to have more space to discuss on other issues than nuclear, meaning renewable and efficiency. We also have to make efficiency more competitive and to improve the competitiveness of our economy through energy efficiency and to provide some rules to have more role between interaction between national, regional, and let's say public audience like us relationship. So this is the main section of the law. I will only focus on efficiency. And the main objective related to energy are the following one. As I told you, the most important one is to reduce the GHG emission by 40% to 2030 and 75% in 2050, which corresponds to what I call the factor four. You are not keen with that, but we have also to follow the objective of the European Commission. And this objective of our national energy transition law are obviously online and even in some sector more stringent than the European objective. But we have also, at least we have to follow the European objective, and this transition law go above the European objective. Second objective, and I think you will be familiar with that, this is a very interesting concept that start to be developed in Europe. Our objective, even on energy efficiency, it's not to say we will save, we will improve our energy intensity or we will make a certain amount of energy saving. We say we will decrease the final energy demand. So this type of objective, which is a quantitative objective, it's even more powerful than an objective for efficiency, which is expressed in terms of energy intensity. So decreasing the final energy demand by 20% in 2030 and 50% in 2050, despite we will have around 1.5 economic growth. So in one end, we will have more activities. Despite that growth in activities, we have to reduce our final demand. So you see how stringent is our objective on that. Third objective, it's on renewable. The share of renewable should increase from 13% to 32% in 2030 in total final primary demand. We have to reduce fossil fuel as we are very short in fossil fuel production. We have some fuel production, very low. And we have to reduce fossil for the fossil in the final energy consumption by 30% in 2030. Of course, it's linked to the objective of CO2, because if we want to reach CO2, firstly, the first option, the most economical option, it's energy efficiency. But obviously, we should have fuel substitution like renewable, and we have to reduce the fossil fuels. Other objective is to reduce, this is the most political difficult objective in the transition law, the most popular one, I may say, for journalists, is to reduce the share of nuclear in electricity mix from, let's say, 80 to 50% in 2025. For those we know the internal situation, our neighbor, the German, want to stop completely to sort out to the nuclear. The French government didn't go so far because the consensus in the French society it's more complete compared to Germany. So the French government, as this is the first time in our history from the first oil shock, that we have an objective to reduce the share of nuclear. So this is why this transition law is a very new concept in our context. Last objective, we have other environmental provision like transport, air quality, etc. This objective, these five main objectives, we have other objectives which are side objective, like combat fuel poverty. Even in a country like France, where the average GDP per capita is around $40,000 per capita, we have 8 million of people which are poor, and maybe 10 million of people in France who are not able to eat as they would like to be eaten. We call it fuel poverty. And this transition law has a role to promote policies to combat fuel poverty. And this is one of our objectives of our ADEME, since we are in charge of the Observatory of the Fuel Poverty. So this is something also new for us, to focus some of our energy efficiency policy in terms of fuel poverty. And as in many countries, and this is, for example, one of the objectives of the WEC, is to provide the right access to energy to all people. This is a classic access, but in our case, there more or less all the French population has access to electricity. So this is more to have access to energy at a reasonable cost, especially for household consumers. For this transition law, of course, provide policies. We have objectives and policies. I will describe some of them in detail, but mainly I will give you a first appraisal about the main policies. On buildings, we have a building code, and the new building, we have to make a building code to reinforce our building code every 5 years. This is a European law, but our building code is considered as the most stringent in Europe right now. And there are, so I will not give you too much numbers, but the current building code provide performance for the new building of 50 kilowatt per square meter. But beyond this building code, for new buildings, we have also advanced label. Label, we go beyond the legislation, like BPOS, etc., which are label for positive energy building. So it's building which will produce energy. So this is also a new concept, and we will have label to promote that type of issue. But in case of France and many parts of Europe, the issue is not new building, as it could be in Mexico, where you have a large rhythm of construction. In our case, the main issue for efficiency is existing stock of building. And the main potential of energy efficiency in France is buildings. And we have around 35 million of buildings in France. And the objective is to have to retrofit 500,000 buildings a year. Yeah. This is more than a doubling of the current effort. So you see, with just this number, that our main effort in efficiency in France is existing building for efficiency. We will promote specific policies like the white certificates. It's an obligation for utilities to make energy saving to their customer. So it's a very specific tool. I will not elaborate on that. but I encourage Mexico to think about this very interesting tool. There are some examples already in Latin America, like in Uruguay and Brazil, but this is more or less energy certificate. It's, I may say, the most important policy we have in France right now, but it's not only for building, it's cover all the other sectors. The, just to provide you the effort or the impact of this policy, it should correspond to 1.5% improvement of efficiency, only with this policy. So this is the main policy we have now. We can consider it's a sort of regulation, but also a market-based instrument. And of course, we have fiscal and economic instrument. Since in the French government, and in particular in ADEME, we believe that it's a mix of policy we should have. We should have first institutional, we should have regulation, but of course, some accompanying measure like fiscal and economic instrument. So we'll have a tax credit, which can be support for several billions of euros per year. We have a zero interest loan, and we have some issue on energy taxes. For industry, we have to follow the program of the European Commission, the what we call the EU ETS, which is a quota of emission for energy intensive industry. We will have a carbon tax. We will have development of ESCOs. And the idea, of course, is to allow the to improve the competitiveness of the industry, for example, through energy management. And we make a lot of effort in innovation and demonstrators, what we call investment for the future. Transport, we will have cleaner transport. One of the objectives, I don't know if it's the French government or the car makers, is to become the leader in electric cars in the next future. We are the lead. We were the leader on small diesel car, but for new issues on air quality, the car makers has to shift from fuel to electricity, and certainly France will promote the electric mobility, not only for cars but for a bus, even for truck, for a bicycle. We will promote car sharing, and we will have a lot of new type of modes that we promote through investment of future. It's billion behind that of effort made by the government to develop the cleaner transport. We will also develop action at the level of territories. All the policies I mentioned here are national policies, but there are a lot of policies which should be implemented also at national and territories. And we have also to think about the linkage and the relationship between the different level, between customers, cities, province and national. And financing, because all these policies need some lubricant, I may say. And this is a financing issue, and we will have an innovation fund. And part of this innovation fund, it's operated by ADEME. It's 4 billion of euros. So this is a huge effort to develop new technologies for the future. If I go to some detail, for efficiency, for a building sector, I will not mention all the policies we have. I will mention some which are, let's say, which have a strong impact or which are original. One, and you will certainly be surprised, I think we are one of the first countries in the world to implementing that. This is the obligation of energy efficiency work in rented building. So you imagine you oblige all the French citizens when they make a new refurbishment, they are obliged to make a thermal refurbishment. This is an obligation. So you imagine it will be very difficult to implement, but if it's working, yeah, it will have a huge, huge impact. So in fact, at the occasion of each classic retrofitting, we will be obliged to make a thermal retrofitting. for existing building. We will have, so there will be some support to do that through credit, tax credit scheme or soft loan. Of course, there will be derogation because in some cities, for example, when you have a historical center, you cannot make a deep renovation with external retrofit. So there will be derogation, and it will be very difficult to make this policy in a huge, huge building. It will be also linked with thermal acoustic, and this is also a multi-benefit of retrofitting. And there will be some action at level of territories. There will be also a classic policy of third-party financing because, as a lot of countries, we have a lack of public budget, and we have to have private partnership, and we will have a third-party financing, and we will create an operational framework to promote the third financing by public companies. We will improve, as I mentioned, the performance of new building. In particular, like in a lot of countries, we will the public sector will have the role of a pilot. So there will be exemplary pilot in public building for energy positive building, what we call NZEB. It's not night, but it's mean net zero energy building. Okay. We also have a possibility for collectivities to impose new construction rules, which are more stringent than the national rule. So, for example, if in Monterrey, the mayor of Monterrey want to be more voluntary than the national law, they, with our own law, he can do it. So this is interesting because, for example, my colleague, which help us in the in our project, is from Grenoble, and Grenoble is ruled by the Green Party, and he certainly can take advantage of this transition law to go beyond the classic policies that we implement at national level. We will have generalization of information provided by the consumer. So we have a regulation, but you have to also increase the awareness of the consumer. In particular, like in a lot of other countries, we don't, the classic French citizen doesn't know which is the best technology, how much it costs, where he can get it. So we need to inform the consumer about the opportunities for energy efficiency. So this is why we will develop what we call the one-stop shop or information center. It's a place where, as a consumer, I want to make energy efficiency works. I will go, I need advice, how much it costs to replace windows, how much it costs to make roof insulation, how much it costs to have a condensing boiler, where I can get it, do you have address for installers, etc. And what's happened before, it's we have center for technical advice. And then I have to go somewhere, it's not clear where, to have to find the financing. So I have to go to my bank, I have to go to discuss a soft loan, to see if I prefer to have a tax credit scheme or a soft loan. And in fact, we have a technical advice and the financial issue which were not connected. And the idea of this one-stop shop was to connect in the same place the technical and financial advice. So this is a new tool, and I think it's also one of the new tools in Europe, which correspond to a barrier, that a classic barrier we have on energy efficiency, to merge technical and financial issues. We will have a generation of smart meters. We have to take into account ICT. And through the law, we will have deployment of smart meter for gas and electricity. And I think they have 4 years, or the objective is in 4 or 5 years, to develop 35 million of smart meters. There are some controversy about the impact of these smart meters. It could be 2% until 6%, but it certainly will allow to improve efficiency. We will set up an energy banknote, which is especially for fuel poverty, which allow for them to pay the energy bill and also to make energy efficiency works. So this is also a new policy. I cannot tell you if it will work because its decree are in discussion. I hope it will be discussed. It's also controversy, but at least this is a new tool directed to poor households. And we have this energy certificate. And in our law, again, a share of this obligation to utilities to make energy saving to their customer, a part of this obligation is dedicated to a poor household. Mm. So this is, as you can see with these two last example, an illustration that our transition law has the objective to improve the situation of the poor income household. Better insulation building, so I will not insist on that because I express already the number of housing. This building code should create 75,000 jobs.
Some jobs, green jobs.
Through a regulation. This is because the level of our regulation is very difficult. We have to train architects, and there is a specific program at ADEME in universities to train the architect to make net zero energy buildings. So there are behind that regulation, there are a lot of side effects because it's not at this level. We need to have standard for product. We have to have agreement of installers, etc. So this is not only a regulation, it has a lot of effect. But the idea is to divide the consumption by two until 2000. We will have urban planning because you can make effort on one building, but you have to think the relationship between building and transport, and it's in the concept of urban planning. And the idea is to have urban planning rule to remove obstacles to insulation of buildings. For example, it's not obvious to make external retrofitting. And personally, I am in a judgment with my neighbor about the fact that he don't want to make retrofitting from outside because I take some space from his garden. So you see this law will simplify at the level of a city the implementation of the energy, what we call the deep renovation in buildings. We will have a tax credit scheme, so regulation, tax credit scheme, because any regulation, any obligation doesn't work without accompanying measures, to be clear, without euros. This is why we will, in parallel, have an energy transition tax credit, which is applicable to 30% of the total cost of work. This is not the most important rate in Europe. I think Italy is 40%, but this is the maximum rate we have applied in France until now. So it's a huge effort, but there is of course a limit, if not it will be too costly, of 8,000 euros. For one single person or one work, up to 16,000 euros for a couple. I use that personally for retrofitting. So I use the tax credit scheme to do that. Another possibility was to use what we call interest-free loan. So this is also a tool which allow for financing. And this is mainly for households we don't have enough capital to invest directly because when you make refurbishment, it costs around 30,000 euros in France or $30,000. There is a huge upfront investment. And this is why for some households it's difficult to have this money at their bank account. So this is why they can go, they can prefer to have an interest-free loan. So I will. This is the main policy we will have, which are, let's say, reinforced compared to the past. So this energy transition law use some classic tool we have before, but with a push with higher rate of support, for instance. Clean transport. We are the first producer of green gas emission. In France, the transport is responsible of 27% of total emission. And obviously, the road transport is a major air polluter, which represents, for example, more than half of the nitrogen oxide emission. So our goal is to reduce the dependency on hydrocarbon, especially in transport. In 2020, 10% of the energy consumed in all modes of transport will be originated from renewable sources. So it could be through biofuels, or it could be through gas obtained by methanization, or it can be through electricity produced by renewable. So, and 2020, it's tomorrow. Yeah. So this is already a huge effort, but there are long-term goal, of course, in transport, because especially in that sector, it takes time to develop new infrastructure. If you want to develop electricity, as I will present later on, to change the market, it will take decades. So this is already a very important objective, and the main issue is to combat air pollution. So we will, the first, and it's, as I mentioned just before, it's effort on electric mobility. In 2015, we have already installed individual charging point for electric car. I have no the exact numbers, but with a tax credit of 30%. So we support the individual implementation of charging point for battery. We have, the objective is to develop 7 million of electric charging points through France by 2030. This is huge. And just to give you how many we have now, we have 10,000. So we have to go from 10,000 to 7 million of charging points in, let's say, 15 years. It's not obvious. Secondly, we will have a funding for clean transport. In particular, we are we call it car bonus. It's a positive way to present that. This is a subsidy for cars to purchase a new vehicle, electric new vehicle, in replacement to diesel. So it's a win-win situation. In one way, we replace diesel, which are not anymore fashionable, in particular for air pollution, and you replace it to electric cars. There are also some controversy about that, because the diesel car a lot of poor income households have diesel car. So this is an issue, how to tackle this issue of low income household to shift to electric car, despite they will have a 30% bonus. As we did in buildings, there will be a pilot or leading example by the public sector. So we will have a 5 billion euro saving fund for the French Deposit and Consignment Office. It's an office in charge of dealing with fund to promote electric cars in their public fleet of vehicles. Just to give you some numbers, technological innovation for cars, 2 liters per 100 kilometer. If I remember well, in Mexico, you are around 7 or 8.
Eight.
So you see, factor 4, what does it mean?
To reduce.
It's to reduce. But factor 4 is not only through technology. Technology will lead or will allow us to reduce a factor 2. But to go to factor four, we have to go beyond technology. But at least, clearly, the technology will be an important contributor of our effort. And we will, of course, promote hybrid car, electric car, lighter car, and different type of technologies, hybrid with charging infrastructure, specific vehicle for urban uses, so it will be very small. Maybe you know the smart car, they are very small, but it will be this type of car. And I think which is very interesting, it's not new, but it's advanced mobility service experimentation, like car sharing, car pooling. When I start, let's say 25 years ago at ADEME, I was in charge of promoting GPS, and I was thinking it will never happen. And now my kids, every Saturday night, is doing carpooling and car sharing. And in our vision, we consider that 30% of the mobility in 2050 could be through car sharing and car pooling. Of course, from expert from my generation, it's difficult to
change to
imagine that. But for the new generation, it's something that at least it's possible. So we will innovative railway, innovative ships, etc. And in our scenario that we have in ADEME, we will consider that 30% shared vehicle, 20% of individual vehicle, 25% of collective transport, 15% bicycle, and 10% two wheels motorized. So this is our objective. I will certainly stop here. Just one word on the role of ADEME. We are implementing policies, but we are not alone. You have the Ministry of, for example, the CO2 tax. It's obviously the Ministry of Finance which monitors the taxation scheme. They will not give that issue to an agency. So we have some policy which are that we have to manage. For example, the EAT fund, the renewable fund, we are implementing that. But even for renewable, we are not alone to implementing renewables. You have also a private sector which is implementing technologies or promoting this technology without the support of ADEME. But ADEME has a certain role to do that, and it's a little bit different as Kone, because in ADEME we go from research to market. We are we don't have laboratory, but we support a lot of research, and we support a lot of prototype. And this prototype, we have a lot of investment for example, clean transport to develop a future urban small vehicle for cities. It's a program of 100 million of euros. So it's what we call investment of future. Of course, we are also precursor of policies. For example, this obligation of energy efficiency work was proposed by ADEME, and it was accepted by the government. We are evaluating the CO2 tax. We are evaluating the impact of the transition law in terms of GDP, etc., with the model 3ME. You will maybe you will have some presentation on that in other occasion, but we have developed in France a macroeconomic model which allow to evaluate the impact of energy transition law on GDP, job creation, on energy bill, all the important information that the decision maker want to have. And this model is, we have a collaboration with the Mexican government to implement this 3ME model in CENER. And so you will be able to have also a macroeconomic impact evaluation of your energy transition law. And I hope it will be useful and workable for you. We are also in a level of development in France. So you see that ADEM is one of the measures as an energy efficiency agency. It's one of the major stakeholders of the energy transition law. And this is why we are we pay attention about all the decree, all the implementation. And finally, we are in charge of evaluating the transition law, and we have used the same model that now is used in KONE, the MedPro model, to develop what we call the shared vision of ADEME. And one of the scenarios was to see the impact of the energy transition law on the energy demand. And we did two exercises, one in 2030 and one for 2050. And the result is we will reduce the final demand from 2010 to 2050 of 46%. So this is a huge potential. And what is important, this is not this type of shared vision. Shared visions means that there were more or less 400 engineers at ADEM which works on that vision. We are specialists on cars, on bus, on heat pump, on everything. Mm-hmm. And they provide their best expertise and their most voluntary potential, I may say, to see what could be the maximum we can reach, but with a mind that we are implementers. We are not utopists, we are not NGOs, we are implementers of policy. So this is a potential of 46% of improvement of the energy demand. So you see that the transition law could have a huge impact on our future of energy. So this is an energy demand, energy transition law, but above all, energy transition law for green growth. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Didier, for your presentation. It's very clear. I appreciate everything that you present this morning for us. For KONUE, it's very important to know what is different experience in your country. As you know, Mexico is implementing our national energy transition law. So KONUE is part of this implementation for our country. So your concepts are very clear for us, and it's very useful, this presentation, not only for KONUE people. I think many people will be checking this presentation in other places. I hope many students will be checking. It's a good presentation.
I am also interested to promote that webinar in France too. I will bring you back.
Perfect. Just for finalizing, I would like to apply some questions for you. One is about the objective. How often are you planning to review the national objective or sectoral objectives about the energy efficiency in France?
As I mentioned, in energy efficiency law, the first topic we discuss is objective. We have national broad objective, like reducing the share of nuclear or improving efficiency of 30%. And we have sectoral quantitative target. So the monitoring will be different according to the type of objectives. In general, in France, every 5 years, the French government will make a new revision of their vision. And at that occasion, they will see again if the objectives are reachable. For sectoral target, I think the updating of this target will be based on the result. I give you the most original target we have in the law is the number of new dwelling, number of refurbishment per year, 500,000. Clearly, it's so ambitious that this target may be not so realistic. And after monitoring of 3, 4, 5 years, we will see if we are able to support the refurbishment of 500,000 buildings per year. So my answer is national targets are reviewed every 5 years. Quantitative sectoral target will be reviewed when the implementation becomes difficult. However, in case of European country, we have also to monitor the European target or the action of France for achieving the EU target. And for that, we have mandatory reporting to the Commission. And now the reporting for efficiency is mixed with the reporting on renewable and CO2. But what you have to understand is that this reporting is mandatory. And the government has to report every 3 years on that common reporting for these three objectives. This is a good message to say that efficiency, renewable and climate should or could be discussed together. You cannot see CO2 target without reflecting about energy efficiency target. An energy efficiency target alone has not too much meaning. So it should be designed in a broader scope. I will insist on the monitoring of this target. And what we are doing, for instance, in this European project you mentioned, Odyssey, and what we are implementing with CONAE about this database on energy efficiency indicators, is clearly to track if you are online with the target. So our ambition with our collaboration is that CONAE will be able to monitor this target. You have the tool, you will have the tool to monitor the national and sectoral target. To summarize, the revision, it's not every year, clearly, but it's every 5 years for the main national broad target and for sectoral target when we will see difficulties.
Thanks. During your presentation, I could see some slide. And when you showed the branches in a dam in different states in France, my question is, what is the role for these branches regarding to the monitoring the targets or the implementing the law now in France? This is a question for her.
Okay. So ADEME is 100,000 staff, and among this 100,000 staff, there are more or less half of the staff which belongs to 13 branches. So it means that more or less 50% for each branch, and these branches are more focused on local activities. So their role is to go to visit companies, to discuss with territories, to cities, to implement projects. Mm. So at headquarters, we are here to design policies. The implementation, it's more at local level. And this is one originality of the ADEME framework, is we have headquarters and we have half of our staff at local level. Their role is clearly to implement policies. They don't make research, they are making awareness, and they are implementing not all policies, but policies which are at the level of territories. This is an originality in Europe, But for example, in case of Germany, the policy, or Italy, the policy is already designed at the level of Landes for Germany or for a province in Italy, which is not in case of France, where we have a more centralized country, where we have a national policies. However, in the energy transition law, and I think I have mentioned that, there is an obligation for all territories to have a climate action plan. Not an energy efficiency plan, but of course in a climate plan, you will have information on efficiency. And this plan has, of course, local objectives, and they have to monitor their objectives. So this is also how the regional level is important. I will insist on that issue, and this is one of the outcome of the COP21 in Paris, that climate change policy or energy efficiency policy, it's applied at different level, national, regional, or even city or citizen level. And in fact, as I work at, I'm not implementing policy myself, it's people which are in the branch. So they are, let's say, our workers or our VI, sellers of policies, I may say. So this is very important to have this level of action or implementation. And since ADEM is one of the largest energy efficiency agency in the world, we have been asked for many countries to provide some how to implement an agency. And we always say that developing national branches are very important. This is the case, for example, in Tunisia or in Romania, where we help them to make an energy efficiency agency. So this level of implementation is key of success for energy efficiency or climate change.
Perfect.
When you were explain us the presentation, you talk about the capabilities in the energy efficiency buildings. What is the role of the ADEM in the planning of designing, or how is the coordination with other stakeholders about designing new roles about the, to build new mayors? I don't know, for build jobs.
Okay, this is an important question for implementers. I will take the case of building codes, or let's say obligation of energy efficiency works. As I told you, we have very ambitious objective on buildings to implement what we call net zero energy buildings. A classic architect do not know how to make a net zero energy building, or even what we call a low consumption building. So we consider that we have to make capacity building for all stakeholders or professionals which are playing a role in the implementation of a building code or a retrofitting policies. There are several, and to be simple, we have one staff dedicated for each type of issue I will mention. First, we have one policy, one program on training in universities or engineering school of architecture for architects to be able to make such type of building. Secondly, we need installers. And ADEM is designing a label of for installers, and there is a list of agreements. They have to have a 3 days training to get this label. And which is important is if, as a customer, I want to make retrofitting and call for installers, if I want to beneficiate of tax credit scheme or zero soft loan, I should use the capacity of installers which have this agreement. So you see, it's not only to give a label to installers, it's also that as a citizen, I cannot have public aids without using the agreement of this installer. I think this is very important, and I think it's a good example. We have also discussion on product, because when you have to reach this level of performances, you have to use different type of product. So it's not only architect, it's not only installers, but it's also the producers. So there are some policies, for example, technological procurement, to force the building material constructor to provide more efficient windows or more efficient product, like insulation products, etc. So what I want to say is that we are developing a program for, let's say, each type of stakeholders. It's not only architects, it's not only installers, it's also promoters, it could be production of material, etc. So this is why implementing a regulation or an obligation of energy efficiency work is not so obvious. We need to go ahead with this type of capacity building, and as I mentioned, and also some financing. And we have also to develop programs or to develop capacity with banks. Because the banks has to finance this energy efficiency works, and this is not a specialty of any bankers to select investment. So we have also a lot of discussion, a lot of capacity building with bankers that they get the knowledge of energy efficiency investment. So you see, this is a large palette of professionals that we have to train.
Okay, you mentioned in this answer some schemes and mentioned some investment that you are developing for this implementation. Could you mention the one or two examples around the effective incentive or taxes or schemes around energy efficiency with this law in France?
First of all, we consider that a CO2, an energy tax or a CO2 tax, it's a prerequisite to have high level energy price. For the classic payback for retrofitting in France could be 15 or 20 years. So you can understand easily the difficulties to push this type of energy efficiency works. This is why we need some accompanying measures, we call it incentive measure or tax, which allow to reduce the level of payback, to make it more acceptable to the customer. So there, I will give you two examples, one for cars. We call it bonus malus. I like this this concept, and I will maybe discuss on the tax credit scheme for in building sector. Bonus malus. This is a very clever instrument from a governmental point of view. The idea is that this policy will be neutral, fiscally neutral for the government. So first, I tax the big cars, like four wheels or very powerful car. The level of taxation can be quite high, up to 2,000 euro. So it's not it's important taxation. And with this revenue of tax, so this is a malus, I can say, with the revenue of this tax, I can support, I can subsidize customers we buy very efficient cars, like electric cars, hybrid cars, etc. So, in fact, the income I get from the malus will allow to finance the bonus for the high efficient cars. So, in fact, if the instrument is well designed, it's neutral for the government. So this is why it's very, very good. To do that, there are some prerequisites, which is first to have a label, to know what is what we call an efficient car or what we call a non-efficient car. This is why we have implemented first a label for cars, and this is a European law where all the countries have to have a label of cars. And you know, encourage all the countries to have labeling on cars. And then we have a label A for efficient car, B, C, D. And we were supporting around 3,000 euros for efficient cars, like A, mainly electric cars, or very, very few efficient cars, and up to 500 euro for label B and C cars, which are also efficient. I know very well this program because my neighbor in the next office to me was evaluating and designing the policy, the program. And it worked so well that in fact it was not neutral to the government. There were too much bonus and not enough malus. So in fact it cost to the public budget. Why? In fact, Adem makes a good calculation, but the government was too generous for what they call efficient cars. Adem was in position to propose to subsidy label A and B car. But for political reasons that I cannot say here, the French government has also proposed to support label C car. And this creates a deficit in the program. Mm. But if it's well designed, this is a very good program from a governmental perspective. Now, as an external expert, there are countries which have only a malus to efficient cars, to non-efficient cars, like in Ireland, and it works also. So the question is, a malus, yes. Do we need to have a bonus, to have a bonus? My answer is yes, in particular for new technologies like electric cars. For a classic efficient cars, in gasoline or in diesel, it's questionable. But I think to promote electric cars, which are efficient cars, I think we need to have a bonus at some point. And what is the level of the bonus? It's maybe at the level of the gap between when you buy the same car in diesel or electric version. This is one way to do that. So this is the first example. The second, so it was very, we evaluate the impact of this policy, and in 2 or 3 years, we are really able to change market share among type of vehicle. I have a figure which are very impressive, where we can say that policy has really changed the market in France in few years. So I always give that example as a good example that policy can work. The second important program we have is for tax credit scheme for energy efficiency work in buildings, in particular for existing building. The question here is what type of massive policy, which is not too costly for the government, can be implemented to allow to have deep renovation. We are not interested to make a policy which supports just the setting up of efficient windows. It's not enough. If we want really to reach our target, we have to combine changes of heating system, maybe to go to heat pump. We have to make roof insulation, wall insulation, change the windows. So it's to go to a deep renovation, meaning to have several or a package of works. Then it means the cost of works is very high as I mentioned, it could be up to 30,000 euros. So you imagine if a government supports 30% of the total cost, it's too much. But we support 30% of the total cost, but with a roof of, I think, 13,000 per household, which is quite important. The idea is to have a policy which allow to have deep renovation. So to have a package of measures, not only one. What is maybe important to say is that you may say at the first impression it's a very costly program, 30% of total energy efficiency works. In fact, you have VAT, you have a lot of other indirect costs that reimburse to the government their subsidies. And in fact, the real cost of government of a 30% tax credit scheme, it's around 5%. So there is an announcement saying the government supports 30%, but after all the other effect, it costs only 5% to the government. So, but this is a good policy, but there are other alternatives like zero soft loan. And we have to, depending on your financial situation, you can prefer a soft loan or you can prefer a tax credit scheme. Or you can say the soft loan is for one work and you get a tax credit scheme when you have several works. I would like to mention that, again, label is very important. To take advantage of this tax credit scheme, you are obliged to use the most performing product. So, for example, the most performing windows, most performing insulation material, and all these materials should be labeled. So, in fact, we have a label for all type of product, and you can take advantage of these fiscal measures or economic measures only if you are using this labeled product. The third point is you have to review the list of products which are eligible. For instance, if we want to promote heat pump, it should be in the list, but not all the heat pump. Maybe we can just support there are different technologies in pump, and we support only performing, most performing heat pump. We can say we stop to support windows because the windows are the least cost-effective technologies in buildings. So this is also a way, playing with a list of technologies that are supporting, that can allow to have a better design. However, it's clear that, in general, incentive have some problems. One is the free riders effect and sometimes the double accounting. I have a personal experience where I was able to benefit of a tax credit scheme and white certificate obligation. And now the idea is to have only to have a unique tool to avoid that as a customer benefit of several subsidies. There were some examples where household has gained of seven different subsidies. Subsidies from national level, subsidies from region, from local, etc. So we have to pay attention to that. But my last message is we cannot implement any regulation without accompanying measures. This is why incentive is always part of the mix of policies.
Thank you. The time is overing, Didier. So my last question is about recommendations with Latin American countries. As you know, many countries in America Latina are starting to follow this tracking about the transition energy laws in different countries. And what do you recommend for these countries? And you have a lot of followers in Latin American countries too.
Yes, we are
a good friends
together. with the United Nations CEPAL in a project gathering the 20 Latin American countries and now Caribbean countries. And we are discussing on indicators, but in fact, when we are discussing on monitoring, reporting indicators, we speak about policies. And we will propose to have a Latin American Energy Efficiency Policy Database in the next meeting in April. And so the recommendation on policies, it's a, of course, difficult job, you ask to me, because between Brazil and Uruguay, or Costa Rica and Mexico, there is no simple solution. So of course, it depends on what we call national circumstances. It's a matter of climate, size of the country, level of education, etc. So it's clear that we cannot apply the same policies or the same policy mix everywhere. But at least there are some fundamentals on policy implementation. This is first a package of policy which is the most effective one, rather than to have one or two unique policies. Secondly, too much policies can kill policies, because there is a certain tendency that every time you have a new government, he wants to have his own mark, and instead of maybe reinforcing one policy, he creates a new policy. And at least we have a certain inflation of policy, and as a customer, we are lost in the bulk of policy. This is what happened in case of France for refurbishing, where we have four policies, soft loan, tax credit scheme, white certificate scheme, and others, and we were lost, which is a good policy. So too much policy can kill policies. However, the policy mix could always have the same type of, main proposal. First, institution. Without any strong institutional framework, you cannot have a strong energy efficiency policy. To be very rapid, institutional issues are energy efficiency law. This is why we are here. Target setting and maybe to implement an energy efficiency agencies. Mexico is lucky to have an energy efficiency agency, Chile, but Brazil do not have an energy efficiency agency. And in particular in Europe, all the country has an energy efficiency agency or something similar. In Latin America, it's not the case. So I suggest at regional level that there are discussions to demonstrate, and CONE is really well placed, to demonstrate that to have an energy efficiency agency, it's allowed to better implement programs. So we have the institutional framework, which is the key of the things. Then, the second issue is prerequisite. Second prerequisite is pricing. You cannot, in one end, support energy, subsidize energy, for example, to promote gas, and on the other hand, the same government to subsidize energy efficiency. In fact, it's a difficult tuning to do that, but without high energy price, it's difficult to implement energy efficiency. See the case where we can, and I think it's one of the cases why Mexico was not implementing efficiency policy in the 80s, because we were oil producers. So, of course, when you go to Venezuela or other oil producing country in Latin America, where the cost of gasoline is below the cost of production, there is no incentive to reduce mileage or to reduce the use of car. So, without any good pricing policy, you have no way. Thirdly, policies. There is different type of policies. Regulation. I always start with regulation. My personal expertise is that regulation is one of the most effective policies. And you know that very well in Mexico with standard. One of your most effective policies are standard. So there are many regulations, building codes, standard for electrical appliances, for electric motors, etc. But you can have also other type of regulation, like mandatory reporting for energy intensive industry, mandatory audit, mandatory energy managers, mandatory energy efficiency works, for instance in France. I will not suggest that policy for the moment in Latin America, but there are many regulations which can be implemented. On regulations, there are very few regulations which are pure energy efficiency regulation. For example, in transport, you have to discuss on to have a speed limitation. Is it for safety? Is it for air pollution? Is it for efficiency? So, in fact, we have to be very modest when we are implementing energy efficiency. We have to discuss with other ministries to have a regulation which have some impact also on efficiency. But a pure energy efficiency regulation become more and more rare. In general, climate or air pollution or energy or sectoral, I call it sectoral policies. So regulation is important and they should be reinforced. Every, for instance, the French building code, there is a European law that all the member states should reinforce their building codes every 5 years. A regulation should be reinforced because the technology is improving. So you can be late compared to the technology on the market. There is an advantage of regulation, it's go very, you can say, okay, tomorrow I change the speed limit in Mexico. But in fact, a regulation is a compromise. Because there's too much stringent regulation, if nobody can apply your regulation, it has no impact. So in fact, a regulation takes time to be discussed, designed, and implemented because it's a compromise. But regulation is the first option. Then a regulation alone doesn't work alone. You have to have accompanying measures, which means economic or fiscal measures. Fiscal measures, when we discuss, we are always shy in your countries about ideas. For example, fiscal measure for imported cars. Fiscal measure for, so you make different type of fiscal level according to the efficiency of the product you import. This is a simple policy. Or you can have VAT reduction for efficient appliances, for instance. And as you see, for all this policy, including regulation, one basic policy, it's label. Label, you can say, label, I don't believe too much in label, because maybe it's not very well designed, it's not... But at least label, it's a key policy for other policy, for regulation, for certification of buildings, for bonus malus. We need to have a reference which is a label. This is why I encourage the country to, let's say, to start with label. And to start label in electrical appliances, mainly in your region, refrigerator, air conditioners, and then to have label in other different products. So label is also important, and the only thing we have to pay attention in subsidies that it's not too costly for the government, and there is no double accounting between policies, which is the most important question. And the second question is the issue of free riders effect, that we have to, your design of subsidies should allow the free riders effect for maybe those which are not let's say confident to that. I have an old car, fine, and I plan to change it next year. I know by the TV that there will be a bonus system next year. What I do? I'm just waiting 1 year to take advantage of the governmental program. So it's a pure free riders effect. In fact, I will change anyway my car. So this is what we call a free rider's effect, and of course, the government doesn't want to support this type of customers. So subsidies, and finally you have a different type of policy on awareness campaign, but awareness campaign, information education, it's also very important because technology is one thing, but a technology that nobody wants, for example electric cars, is not obvious. Very efficient buildings, there is a maybe health problem, there is a, some comfort issues, so you have to sell also efficiency. So this is why you have a lot of policies, from awareness campaign to label to audits to all these type of policies, training, what capacity building, education of architect or eco-driving for taxi, for bus drivers, etc. So this is another type of policies. So to summarize, we need to have all this. You cannot only have regulation, you cannot have subsidies. This is a mix of policies. We make the difference. Now, what is the best tuning? This is depending on national sequences. Some countries prefer regulation, countries are more keen with subsidies, etc., etc. Last point on regulation, a regulation without compliance has no impact. And finally, and it's why we are working personally together, all these policies should be monitored or evaluated. And it's difficult to say at which level we should evaluate, but maybe 1% of total program cost could be allocated to impact evaluation of policies. So this is also important, because to design a policy is fine, to implement a policy is fine, but to redesign, to take advantage of policy implementation, we have to monitor and to report. So you see, this is a long work, and this is why we need an agency to have to push the government to this specificity of efficiency, which is a quite technical issue. It's not, to be frank, it's more complicated to implement energy efficiency policy than renewable. It's less bankable, it's less sexy. This is why we need to have a dedicated professional and dedicated agency to promote efficiency. And finally, don't forget that energy efficiency first, compared to renewable, to CO2, you cannot reach your CO2 target without efficiency. Efficiency is the most efficient and crucial option for climate change. Thank you for attention, and
thank
I hope
too, Didier,
that our audience will be let's say very active and to implement efficiency. This is the future of energy. Thank you.
Thank you, Didier. Well, great final that you gave us. I would like to say you thank you for your concept, for your
pleasure.
Presentation. Everything was very clear. And well, see you, Didier. Thank you for this morning. See you the next time. This is our first webinar in the planning area here in CONUE. So thank you for participating. It'll be part of this experience for me and for CONUE too, and for you too, because
thank
this
you.
Is the first time for everyone here in the room. So see you the next time with another webinar in the planning area in energy efficiency. And I don't know if you have the last comment, or everybody said.
So we are really happy to work with our sister organization CONAE. And we just know from last, week, that the French cooperation is able to continue our collaboration with CONAE for the next year. So, and I will be very happy to continue to share this experience together. We learn from you, and I hope we learn also from us.
Perfect.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
See you the next time.